I think the reason I became a writer was to explain the world to myself.
The human being is compelled to make music or to have music in their lives.
I can't remember a time in my life that I haven't been drawn to needing to make a mark of some kind.
When people see me move, or they see me perform, or they see me dance, I think it gives them a deeper understanding of who I am.
If I can be the one that's making people laugh, there's no better feeling.
Now, the moment when you finally get a breakthrough is heaven.
My junior high school teacher inspired me greatly as a viola player. I started playing the viola in seventh grade. He was my orchestra teacher, and he was very supportive of me. And during my seventh year in junior high school, he introduced me to his father, who was a viola teacher, who was a professional. He actually worked on Broadway. I studied with him for 6 years, through junior high school and high school. When I was going to a junior high school in a black neighborhood in Brooklyn, Mr. Hirsch came to me and said, "I am transferring to Midwood High School." And at that time, Midwood was one of the best schools in the city. And he says, "I'm taking your records from the principal's office, and don't tell anybody, just show up at Midwood High School." And I really think that if it wasn't for that, I wouldn't be playing the viola. That was very, very impactful. And it just made me believe even more that it takes a village to really get someone to rise.
Virginia Woolf's Her Writer's Diary. I have kept it beside me as a writer, on my desk, near me, as a touchstone. When I'm stuck, I open it randomly to just any page, like it's the I Ching. I just open it, and Virginia always has something for me, almost eerily so. I would consider Virginia Woolf a mentor of mine, though I obviously never knew her.
Well, what has influenced my creative life was that it was heavily supported in the home where I grew up. My mother is a watercolorist, and my father, during the war, besides working on the Manhattan Project, he was an usher at the old Metropolitan Opera House, and saw premieres of Jerome Robbins ballets, and she saw Jerry Robbins dance, and took my mother on dates there. So music, art, opera, symphony orchestras, all of those wonderful things that humanity makes when humanity is at its best was in the home I grew up in.
When I'm in the studio and I'm really creating and things are going very, very well, there's a sense of flow, a kind of challenge and accomplishment that are very well balanced. It's almost timeless. It's a very positive feeling, and it's one that is not always there per se. And when it is there, I really honor it and give all the energy that I can to let it keep going.
I would say that sensation is more, it's like a beautiful hum. You're just floating, but you're getting all sensations of sights and sounds, and it's almost nirvana, but yet there's so many things going on that you have to be in control of. Your breathing, your fingers to press the right valves down, your articulation, and it's all careful stuff, but all of that physical, technical stuff becomes automatic pilot, and then the music just showers down on you. All of a sudden, you're right in the middle of it, and it's the most amazing feeling.
There's a feeling of ecstasy sometimes, you know, jubilation, like riding the wave, the crest of a big laugh or a big round of applause. And it's like, whew, I'm doing what I love to do, you know, and it's happening. And those people are with me and we're, you know, feeding off each other. And I literally love going out on stage every single time. I'm just weird that way.
You know, I think we're all a little bit crazy doing what we do. You do have to set aside family, friends, and, you know, thousands and thousands of hours of practice and also building things and having to tear them down and going down one path and having to set that aside and say, no, that isn't it. And then you finally get there. And I think, and most people will just give up. It's a will, it's a focus, and it's just that I'm not leaving this spot until I get to it. I get to what's up here or what's here or what I need to put down on the page. And I love that. I love being in that flow.
Dance is a very essential aspect of it because we just move. You know, dance from different cultures, like I'm from India, it has a particular phraseology, but so does ballet or so does flamenco. But if you remove those kind of definitions, we all move. Then we have a confidence and an empathy towards each other. We become curious about each other to know who I am and who you are. That allows us to form a much stronger human connection, and beyond the human, a more universal sort of understanding of even why we are here.
Writing is really important because it builds empathy. It allows you to get into another person's skin and know what it feels like to be that person. I think the more people read and the more people write and they're not afraid to put their feelings down and they're honest, the more everybody's going to just understand and know each other even a little bit better. And to me, that's crucial. That's just really, really important.
Beauty is no longer it's no longer what people aspire to. And I think that that's because we live in a time where the reality is that we are incredibly vulnerable. So I think as a musician, what I do is bring beauty to people. I make them sit still. If I don't make them sit still, I bring them to a place where they do sit still. I show them loveliness. This, I think, is really, really important because when people come to die, they always want music. That's what they want. There's not a funeral that doesn't want music. There's not an important moment in your life where you don't want music. There's a reason for that. It's ultimately the most amazing thing we do as human beings.
Of all the artists who've lived in my time, the one who means the most to me personally is probably Ingmar Bergman. And I would say that my dad taking me to see Wild Strawberries when I was 7 years old, it was like some kind of rebirth. I just left the theater almost unable to speak because I was so incredibly moved by it. How much did I understand? I don't know. But it was like, my God, there is this deeper level.
Playing music and jazz from a young age, it brought me into contact with all different kinds of people, all different kinds of cultures. It was really important for my self-development, I mean, as a human being, because I came to know people that I might not have come to know and realize, you know, we're people. Doesn't matter what your religion is, what your race is, what is, we love this music and we're playing together. And I think it helped me to become more sensitive as a human being to, you know, the human condition.
I think one of my earliest recollections of seeing something that really made an imprint, probably on what it is that I'm doing now, is the collection of Stephen Sondheim. I saw a VHS tape of Into the Woods as a child, and that pretty much set me on a course for knowing that I wanted to do whatever it was that they were doing.
It's sort of like waiting for a train. Say the train would come in Times Square, and you wanted to get an express train. I wanted to go back to the Upper West Side, and it would come, but it would not stop completely. It would kind of, you hear it coming, it would come whisking by. It would slow down a little, and you better get on that thing. So you better start. The typing is how you're getting on. You're sort of latching into that story.
It's a very unique language, and I think underneath that language, within the body, there's all these subconscious things that are able to come out. In many cultures and places around the world, dance is used as a form of celebration, as a form of mourning, as a form of spiritual connection, and entertainment.
The impetus has been there to capture what we see around us into drawings. Into images, you know, from the cave paintings all the way to now. It's always been there. I just think we need that human touch. We need something that's made by hand that connects with our brains and our hearts and minds.
As I'm pasting pieces of paper down or cutting them up or tearing them, there's a moment that I dissolve, that I can't really pay attention to the separation of the piece that's in front of me or where I am. My body and my energy lifts, and then I know I'm able to move within the thing I'm creating.
I kind of liken it to a runner's high, where you get to that point where you consciously can think, oh, I can do this forever. You know, I could run 50 miles, you know, that point in the run where you're like maybe like 7-8 miles in, where your body's warm and you're in a good rhythm, and it doesn't last a long time, right? Like by mile 10 or 11, you're like, you know, when does this end? And I kind of get to that runner's high moment in my writing almost every day.
I would say one of the most important things that influenced my creative life initially was Steve Martin. Bill Murray, the very early years of Saturday Night Live. When I first discovered Steve Martin, somebody said, oh my God, Jay, you have to know who Steve Martin is. I think he did a stand-up set on Johnny Carson, and it was the silliest, nonsensical, most genuinely hilarious thing I've ever seen. And I thought, oh my God, here's this guy who's a soulmate. I have to do that.
I can definitely say that my mother has been the strongest influence because she's the one who saw it first and she's the one who tried to nurture it almost like a little plant. So when I was doing comics, which my father introduced me to, you know, it was like comics, you know, you're never going to be able to make a living off of that. But I don't necessarily know if I need to. It's something that I have to do. Doing stories for children of color specifically, especially girls, is something that really means a lot to me. And especially when I see kids, like, look through my books and I see their eyes light up, and it's so great. You know, as a kid myself, I never saw comics that had characters that looked like me or had my hair type or anything like that. So it's something that I kind of have to put out for kids, but also for myself, because I just want to see it out in the world.
So I went out to the Mesa and I dug up pigments, and then I had paper that I couldn't get big enough paper, so I would weave it into bigger pieces, and I began to make these things called paper weavings. And when I got to San Francisco, I was a big hit. You know, here's this artist from the Mesa, he's making paper weavings. And I had all this success, and I had gallery representation, I had reviews, I was the envy of all my art school friends, and I was like 24, 23 really. So it was sort of amazing, and within 2 to 3 years, I hated it. I hated it. I would go to the gallery and they would say, you know, the earth tones really sell. And I would find myself in the studio, like when I would reach for a blue, my hand would shake. And I would think, earth tone, earth tone. Bit by bit, it really undermined what my art was. And I actually had to make the decision to leave the West Coast, return to the East Coast, kind of start over. And I had the real surprise of creating a new trajectory in my life where I thought, I'm always going to make art, but I'm going to be really careful about how I let myself be marketed or how I let others control it.
The act of reading is an act of empathic imagination. It's to connect with a character, to connect with a protagonist, to connect with a narrator, to connect with a historical figure, depending on what you're reading. And it requires work. It takes a little bit of work. It's not simply an act of sitting back and receiving the way one might watching something, you know, watching a film, say, or watching television, or even listening to a piece of music.
So I spent a whole lot of time in the library, and I was always asking the librarians, do you have any books about people like me, little Jewish girls with asthma? And they never did, but they began to give me books and tell me stories about kids who had lung diseases and tuberculosis and all this stuff. And I got lost in it, and I felt less alone, and that was a tremendous gift.
I am a trumpet player. I am a freelance trumpet player, which means I go hither and yon to whomever wants my services, being able to perform with all of these different organizations and getting to play specific pieces that I listened to as a teenager, like Mahler's Second Symphony. My whole being just lit up from the very first note of that piece. Startling the way that begins. I was probably the only high school kid in Brooklyn who knew that piece existed, but the first time I performed that in 1988, I will never forget it.
Because I was very quiet as a child, shy, skinny little kid who was always off to the side. But if this aunt or uncle would start telling some kind of a story, particularly a funny one, or a kind of a frightening one, that would perk me up, and it would perk everyone else up. That was very cool. So I think that stuck, and I think that's inspired me to write. Another thing would be sports, and I cringe saying this because among writers, boy, are sports despised. But it's just true for me. I grew up playing them, I grew up watching them, and there's something about the end of a game, win or lose, that miraculous game-winning shot from 50 feet out, that Hail Mary touchdown pass thrown by Bart Starr. I grew up being a Green Bay Packer fan, say what you will about Wisconsin. And everyone in the crowd stands up and cheers, and we're all in love with what's going on. You know, that's the best. That'll get me kind of teary-eyed. But if you could string together 300 pages in a novel, and at the very end, the reader would feel like that, a bunch of them, and they'd all be thinking, wow, then you'd have something.
I would say that there's something very personal about my work that goes a little deeper than what people may think about me. So I think I'm always trying to express how I experience the world that I live in. But when I'm doing my own choreography, it just feels like 100% authentically me, that like I'm moving in a way that I can only express through movement. So it's being able to speak without saying anything.
I'm not aware of my body. I'm not aware of any physicality of what I'm doing. It's all part of the idea from my brain through my hands and feet that I've consciously practiced it for so long that it's in my subconscious, it's in my motor memory, and it's not a conscious thought at all anymore. The conscious thoughts come when other musicians I'm playing with may stray from their goal, and my job is to help them rope them back in, or the opposite, if it's a jazz situation, help them to stray further. And I use whatever I have in my musical intellect to help that out, to make that happen, to encourage it, to support it. So I'm not thinking when I'm playing when music is right.
Well, I think when I'm performing on stage, I feel myself. I wonder if that's how, you know, the fetus feels in the womb, or is that how a spaceman feels? It's an abandon of time. And you feel very large and very small all at once. You feel suspended. You feel incredibly in charge and incredibly vulnerable all at once. It's all the opposites put together.
There's at least 100 people at the stage door every night. And you come out and see those little faces, and they're just they've been transported, and they are seeing theater for the first time, and they're gonna remember that moment, you know, forever. It is something that they can't get anywhere else. You know, it's not like going to a movie. It's not like going to a sporting event. It's not like anything else when they go and they hear that music and they see these people on stage and they get lost in the story. You know, it is an enhancer of life that you can't find anywhere else.
I think that kids need to be told, but especially black girls and black boys need to be told that they are beautiful, that they are smart, that they can do what they want, that they have potential, that they can have adventures too, that they can create their own worlds, that they can create characters, that they don't have to wait for someone to do that for them, that they can give themselves permission to explore the universe of their mind, which is vast and never-ending.
I'd have to say that one of the reasons I got interested in so many different things was because the world, I really didn't understand the world. I didn't understand what people wanted me to do, how to act, how to behave. So really from a very early age, it was listening to music where I'd feel like I was making sense through the music, or drawing maps, or drawing dinosaurs, or doing anything like that. And I would say that's sort of been the way it's been all my life. Writing was my way of finding a way of telling them what I felt and getting outside of myself. And the better I got at it, the less locked up I was.
Well, I started quite young playing the alto saxophone. I was never very good, but I switched to the baritone when I was in junior high school, and I took to it very quickly. And as a result of that, many opportunities opened up for me. I think of myself as a musician. I think of John Coltrane as an artist. But I want to say something about A Love Supreme. He must have been experimenting and thinking about spirituality and religious matters for a long time. But this, I think, was his first real expression, you know, through music. The opening theme of A Love Supreme, you know, it's a collection of fourths. Ba ba da da, ba ba da ba da be da, etc. And some years later, my wife and I were at a synagogue for the high holiday services, and one of the themes for Yom Kippur was almost exactly that melody, of course, with a little different rhythm and stuff. And I started thinking about it, and not that he copied it or anything, but there was something about that theme that had some kind of spiritual significance. And that's one of the things I love about John Coltrane. When I see him playing, or when I listen to him playing, I got to see him once, which was pretty amazing, but it's almost like he's praying. And I've never seen any other musician like that before, but he's like, he's reaching for something.
One of the things that that originally made me want to be a writer was my upbringing, which was, you know, when I grew up in a pretty privileged household. My parents kind of lived the immigrant dream. They were the success story. They came to America with nothing from China and became these huge successes. My dad was an engineer, made good money in Silicon Valley. We had very comfortable lives, but there was sort of a underbelly of unhappiness in our family and dysfunction. And I think what fascinated me about, you know, our lives and my upbringing in particular was this sort of disconnect between the narratives that are external and are popular and what we think of as our lives and the actual reality of what, you know, what it's like to live and breathe, you know, our lives on a daily basis and through the years. And, you know, my novels, you know, usually have something to do with sort of a family's underbelly, some sort of dysfunction, in a funny way. You know, my novels are comedic. So I think, you know, my art form is the reason that, you know, I've been inspired in that art form is to address sort of that tension between, you know, our realities and what sort of the dominant narratives are, you know, out in the world.
I was very inspired by Fred Astaire and Gene Kelly, because that's all the access I had in India at that time. All I wanted to do was tap dance. I did not want to do Indian dance. So I would look at the tap dancing and I would try to imitate them and try to see how I could put that into my Indian dance, but make it Indian. The idea of touch was alien to me. If somebody touched me, we would sort of like, you know, go away and say, why are you touching me? Because that's not there in my form. In a way, I was rediscovering my own body from the inside. You know, if there was a particular way of moving, all of a sudden with these new elements, the internal way of moving shifted and changed. So the outer expression changed as well.
It's always surprising when it's going well, because you never know what's coming up. The unexpected starts happening. And then instead of some writing it, all of a sudden, it's almost like someone else is doing the right, is channeling through me. And it just feels really exhilarating, because I don't know where it came from. I just know that it's there and it's alive and it's breathing. And I feel so incredibly happy. It's better than any drug I ever took when I was young. It really is. And you always hope it's going to happen again, and there's no way to control it, so it's always a surprise when it does happen.
When I'm on stage doing stand-up comedy, the thoughts just come. The associations that you make in the moment with the audience, and whereby you're creating the fertile groundwork for new comedy bits that you will later go write and struggle with, all that groundwork gets laid often when you're totally in the moment, having fun with the audience. There's no self-consciousness. I would say nervousness and self-consciousness are really antithetical to the creative process.
When I am playing and I'm ill at ease, it's because I'm nervous. A lot of times I think it's like a sport. When I watch the Olympics often, I identify with the divers and these people who a millimeter of mistake, it's the wrong note. There's an exactitude that has to be there that can just freak me right out. When I'm ill at ease, it has to do with nerves. And I've always struggled with that in my playing.
We, as musicians, have to get present really fast and maintain it for long periods of time. And I think that's one of the it's a gift and it's also a real challenge. And I find that checking in with my body, I just literally do this thing where I wiggle my toes, I get in touch with my breath, and I connect with all the sounds that are going on around me. And that sets the stage for being present in any particular moment. Now, in terms of what I'm feeling, if I'm really in that flow, if I'm really performing well, if things are firing on all cylinders, I think you could drop a brick on my foot and I wouldn't feel it, because that's, I'm in it, I'm there, and there is nothing else. And nothing feels more vital than that when everybody, you know, gets in that place where we're not thinking about anything else except right here, right now.
Everything else just falls away. Things that are going on in my personal life or at work, things I worry about, you know, my mom and how she's doing or how I'm doing, health, money, the future of the country. It's like somebody in the room just tells all those people to shut up, you know, and it gets very quiet. But I become very pulled into the world, and that's something that has been like that ever since I was a kid.
Music is a reflection of the human condition, and it's a reflection of most importantly to me, a reflection of leadership in morality, in education, in discipline, in responsibility, because music leads you to, I think, a freedom. And freedom comes with responsibilities. I've been in the room with certain artists who I consider totally free when they're performing. And, you know, I think about, as I'm watching, I think about what is it that has gotten them this far? You know, they master that inanimate object at an early age, and then they're able to use that tool to climb this ladder to freedom, you know, and to creativity.
I think that a 8-year-old Betsy, a 10-year-old Betsy, you know, a younger self would have said that the goal is to be a Broadway star, to be on Broadway. I think for lack of knowing better, it was very result oriented. And I think that's probably the best gift of time and knowledge and experience, is knowing now that it's actually not the result that inspires me. It's the process. I can look at credits or accolades and think that's wonderful, but my takeaway is always, what was it like to work on it? How did I feel? What was challenging? What am I learning? And then most importantly, what are you sharing?
As a drum set player, everything you do is exposed. And all the great drummers that I heard play and worked with and recorded with, because I was lucky, I played with them as a percussionist. So I learned a lot from them. We all have one thing in common. We carry ourselves with great confidence because we have to. That we're in the hot seat, we get the most criticism and we get the most commentary from our colleagues and from our leaders. Some are very benign and some are just so insipid and idiotic that we learn to have a kind of a protection.
I can remember being in a gallery once, and it was not the opening, it was another time. And there were just groups of people like standing around having big discussions about my work. They were talking about what it meant to them and their lives. And that's what it was all about for me. So, and that just sort of validated all of, you know, working till 1 o'clock in the morning after my son goes to bed and you know, all the craziness that you go through. So so that's a very strong memory for me. I'm a violist at the Metropolitan Opera, so I have to say that the singing that I've heard over more than 25 years has greatly influenced my creative life. It's greatly influenced my musicianship. Listening to it night after night after night, that's the way we all want to turn a phrase. That's the way we all want to approach a melody. That's emotionally so direct, almost raw, that's what you want as a musician. You want to imitate that in the best way you possibly can.
I want to have the same feeling I did when I was a kid and I read something that really spoke to me. And I remember, you know, I'd be reading something and I'd love it and I'd just close the book at some point and just hold it out in front of me as though to say, how was this done? What miracle, what sort of immortality has been conveyed with this?
Do I have to make you laugh? Maybe I have to make you laugh. Maybe it shouldn't be so serious. Maybe it should not be in the least political. Maybe I should never, ever try to write from the point of view of a woman or a black person or the reasons why people hate each other and don't understand each other. Maybe I should just dodge all that and just make you laugh. So I'm not saying there's no hope for it. There has to be, otherwise why are we here, Marcia? Why am I even talking to you? Why did I come down here? And why are you doing this film? We want to know, we still want to know, is that high we feel when a story is there worth it for more than just us? Are the other people really buying it? I mean, do they even care? We want to believe that translates into something that they really, really want.
If you listen to music and don't try to criticize it, don't try to think about it, don't try, but just let it happen, that could have a very transformative kind of situation in a way that maybe reading a book doesn't, or looking at something doesn't, but that when you're listening to music, you're listening to something that's higher than language.
I've taken myself off of social media. I've taken myself away from the television. I barely listen to the radio and the news, and people think it's political of me. And for me, it's about creativity. It's about really paying attention and really being aware of this sort of thing we go through, this sort of human connection, but it's also sort of just what comes up.
I go to bed and I can't wait to wake up in the morning to do it. And that's just been the biggest gift of a feeling. As a writer, and I've been doing it for pretty much as my sole occupation for the last 3 or 4 years, it's been an amazing experience. It's just a world of difference, and you know, it's hard to explain to other people what that feels like, because you know, we all have complicated lives, but to be able to do it is just such a gift.
There can never be too much music, and there can never be too much dancing. Hearing music and dancing. You see a toddler hearing music and they start to dance. My children did it. And if that isn't proof of that music is the most powerful force in the world, I don't know what is.
One reader, one book, at one moment. It's very private. And so that idea of this private act of empathy, this private inclining of the self in the direction of compassion and understanding, and I can't think of anything more urgent that we all need right now than that sense of being able to enter the mind of someone who may think differently than we do and discover the common ground.
Even though I've been doing this for 25 years since I got out of acting school, I literally feel like things are just starting, like, in a whole new way right now. My name is Robert Creighton.
Oh, my God.
I'm turning these phrases like they're vocal. It was a pleasant surprise. It had gotten into my blood. It was there. My name is Mary Hammond.
I think as human beings, the bulk of us, the 99%, pretty sure we want story. My name is Mark Wisniewski.
Because I think as human beings, we are drama. Drama is a combination of music, movement, and theater. Storytelling, really. My name is Preeti Vasudevan.
There is a level of daily exploration that I enjoy as part of the creative experience, and it's one of the reasons I keep going back. My name is Leland Chuck.
And I'm just joyful and grateful that I'm a musician and I've found this world, and I think it's found me as well. My name is Kenny DiCarlo.
Because really, art's a part of our culture, it's a part of our humanity. It's how we express ourselves, it's how we communicate to each other in ways that are unlike any other way. My name is Lou Story.
Even people who may not speak the same language, movement can be a way to connect them, you know, and the body doesn't lie. My name is Donald Shorter.
What are you noticing? What do you hear? What do you smell? You know, are you fully present and noticing what's around you? My name is Danny Shapiro.
I've always found, you know, we all see art in different ways and we all take things from an object that we see, be it a painting, a sculpture. We're going to bring all of our own things to it. But if we can come together and pause in that moment, I think we've reached someplace very special. My name is Tiffany Dugan.
Part of the creative process for artists is to, you know, study what came before so you can create something new. My name is Maxine Roach.
You can create your own light. You can take your light and you can, you know, watch it burn and you can draw. My name is Micheline Hess.
What people are going to remember, know our civilization by, will be by the art that we leave behind, by the relics that we leave. And I just think it's so important to keep that going. My name is Eileen Kennedy.
By reading someone's work, you get to enter another life and to really understand it on a deeper, intimate level than you might just in knowing a person. My name is Caroline Levitt.
You know, once you're gone, you can't do it with your charm. You can't do it with your connections. But if you manage to write something that will somehow break through and actually reach somebody new who knows fundamentally nothing about you, I think that's a pretty cool thing. My name is Tim Page.
Playing music or whatever it is that your particular art form is helps you to become more sensitive to humanity and the world in general. My name is Roger Rosenberg.
I know that my best work comes when things have been shaken up. My name is Betsy Wolf.
That's why people come to concerts, to put everything else aside and forget about whatever else is going on. My name is Pete Donovan.
And so music has always been a part of it. It's not until I grew up that I realized how integral it was for people being together and being happy as humankind. My name is Jim Saperito.
I mean, I think the world needs art. I think without art, there's no point in any of it. Without creative expression, there really is no world, no world worth living in. My name is Jay Potter.
God's blessing keep you always. May your wishes always come true. May you always do for others and let others do for you. May you build a ladder to the stars and climb on every rung. May you as if change.